There we go. We're on.
All righty. Welcome, everyone. This is a budget meeting of the Portsmouth Police Commission, our second one for the budget session of the 2021-22 budget cycle. And today we're going to get a few more updates, and we're delighted to have City Manager Karen Kennard with us today, who's going to provide some opening thoughts and suggestions, and I assume. And then we will move on to a presentation by Karen Senecal, our business manager, and comments from the chief, and questions, comments, and suggestions from the commission. So again, this is a workshop style budget session. The initial agenda item was public input. At the moment, we do not have any members of the public who've joined in. And we also included a public comment session at the end. So maybe we'll get some folks near the end. So with that as the introduction, City Manager Kennard, thanks for coming, and we're looking forward to hearing what you have to share.
Thank you for having me, and it's my pleasure to be here. I asked both Chief Newport and the Chairman of the Commission if it would be okay to join you, and really in a show of solidarity to understand what you're all going through and to have you understand what we shared with the Council initially, and to really stay you know, unified and collaborating on the best budget that we can, understanding that we're all very important. We all represent very important components of the overall city budget, to which we're all one big part of. So the message that from the that I gave to the council back on January 7th, was one of reminding them that this is a multi-year budgeting process. We are conservative and speculative in nature. And that's been the key to our long-term financial health, and the best practices that we maintain keep us in that good stead. FY22 will really serve as a bridge and a reminder of what we needed to achieve back in FY21, which we're currently in, as well as what needs to be in place for next year and beyond in terms of careful, prudent restoration of infrastructure, maintenance of existing assets, rolling stock, and continued capital investments. The thing we've stressed is that this budget really needs to take on a heightened focus on staffing, services, and expenditures. We will have to look at every possible opportunity for efficiencies and collaborations, because it's going to be as challenging, if not more challenging, than the fiscal year that we're in. Last year, we made the conscious choice to make some one-time cuts and delays in spending that will have repercussions in the next fiscal year and beyond, and we need to be sensitive to that. There will be significant legal and contractual obligations that you've heard me speak about, most notably salaries, COLAs, the impact of the retirement number on our budget. And we're still in a pandemic, so we need to keep all these things in mind, but we will weather the financial storm because we have this long history of fiscal prudence and responsible budgeting. So really what I wanted to say is we have to be careful not to do anything beyond what is absolutely needed this year. There's no magic message here other than to say we have to be careful again. And yet we don't want to decimate the rolling stock and the infrastructure needs and the capital outlay. So there's a heightened sensitivity to all of this. We feel that most notably on the general government side. And I wanted to speak directly to the police commission, the fire commission, and the school board and relay that same message. Again, back to where I started with, we're all key components of the same big budget. And I want to stay in communication with you all as we go through this process. So we kicked off on January 7th. I know this is your second meeting to discuss budget. I appreciate just having a few minutes and would make the standing offer to continue to work well with the chief and Karen as we move forward. So
terrific.
I wanted to share.
Thank you.
So yeah, some big picture guidelines, likeness necessarily, and we'll do our best, we promise. I don't know if you want to, how long you plan on staying with us here today. We're going to review some items. You're welcome to stay with us throughout the meeting, offer additional comments if you like, or pop some popcorn late evening and watch it on replay by
yeah.
It's riveting stuff.
Bit, if you'll have me, I will jump off for a 4 o'clock meeting, but it's important for me to hear the communication that you all have. As much as it is to convey information to you, I want to hear the chatter and how you work as well. So I'll turn off. I'll be happy and observant. How's that?
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Before we say goodbye, thanks for making the time to be with us today. But can you shed any light on additional assistance or the potential for the city to receive reinforcement in light of COVID? Are you getting any inclination as to how some additional relief might shape or could potentially impact budgeting?
That's a great question, Commissioner. And up to the election, it was clear the municipalities were not going to see any relief. I imagine that will change with the new administration. I'm hearing about funds available through schools. But beyond that, I don't have much specificity, but you can be sure we will be on the lookout for that because it would be great to augment what we're already planning. And yet we'll also operate on the assumption that we may not get anything. But you know, we have a lot to be proud of. We have a very stable and predictable budget, and the goal will be to keep this particular year's effort to be as close to as stable and predictable as we can. So we're proud of the work we've done, and we'll continue to be as transparent and collaborative as possible.
Commissioner Shaheen, do you happen to know anybody in Washington, D.C. that might have some inside information for us?
Well, she happens to be somebody who's actively and aggressively been championing direct relief for states and municipalities. So I know she's working alongside, you know, city leaders to try to make this happen. I think it would be useful. I appreciate the city manager's challenge that you can't bank on any of that to come through. So you have to manage the budget, presuming it isn't going to be there. But I think there's also a role we could potentially play in helping to advocate. And so maybe as we're thinking through the budgeting process, where there are expenses, for example, related to overtime because we've had people out with COVID or having to quarantine because of COVID, like trying to identify and potentially isolate how those costs have impacted our budget, just so that we have that data as the advocacy efforts ramp up for this.
Yeah. Has anyone speculated to either to you, City Manager Kennard, or Commissioner Shaheen, when the Biden administration might be able to provide some relief funding for municipalities, given we've got to dry the ink on our new budget in early June, if I'm not mistaken, right? If it's way down the road, it's not going to help us much, right? We kind of need to know by what, March,
April? We publish our budget and make it available to the council by the end of April. Yeah. And we have to budget by the end of June. Sorry, Commissioner.
No. That's helpful. My understanding is that President-elect Biden is expecting to roll out, my dog just let out a big noise. President-elect Biden is supposed to present his proposal for additional COVID relief. And he's, as I understand it, mostly from media reports, it sounds like he's asking the legislature to gear up to take on a new relief package that's really more of a stimulus package, which should include supports for states and municipalities as soon as he's sworn in, along with his cabinet appointees. So, you know, that it sounds like that's going to be one of the very first priorities.
Excellent. Well, good. So with that as a kind of a backdrop, where do we go from here, Chief? We've got a presentation from you and Karen.
Yeah, Karen has put together a PowerPoint that she'll put up that will kind of give us the budget 101 and, you know, the building of the budget and where we're projecting.
I'm going to switch to my computer now, too, if someone can let me in, if you see me.
Actually, I think if you can come in as a panelist, you just come in.
Great, got it.
Okay. This is just a very, very, very basic presentation, just to piggyback on what we discussed back in December. And when we had that meeting, we discussed how we built our budget, that we started with our strategic plan. We looked at our staffing, our org chart. We looked at overtime, how we do our calculations for overtime. And then we looked at all of our other operating line items. There's a link on our website for a prior year's recorded work session that goes line by line by line by line. I think it took us four or five hours to get through that and discuss all the different line items. So we're not going to dive into the weeds at this point, but you can review it at your leisure if you're interested. You might need a couple of cups of coffee to keep you awake for that. But anyway,
It was a good exercise, Karen, for the commissioners and the public a few years ago when we did it. I'm not sure, I don't think we'll do it again this year, but certainly the commission will take a look line by line. But if the public wants to see how many lines there are and how so much of the budget is structurally set before we even start this process, it would be beneficial. Do you know exactly where the public can go and see those two sessions we held probably 3-4 years ago?
I think it's under public resources on the drop-down band at the very top.
Yeah, and if so you can't find it, if somebody can't find it, just contact Karen or myself and we'll make sure you get to the link.
Correct. We're still refining the FY22 budget numbers. As stated at the last meeting, this slide presented on December 30th was a very, very, very preliminary budget. It was based on just global estimates. We've pretty much got the salary benefit done. It's in process of being proofed right now to make sure I didn't make any mistakes. So we're not going to have any final numbers probably till the end of the month or early next month. Excuse me. Preliminary numbers look like it's going to be under the 600,000 that we presented as an initial. Just not sure how far below that will be, but we're making every effort to, you know, cut lines if we can and change formulas here and there. But we just don't have any control over things like our service maintenance agreements. They do not go up by the COLA. They usually go up by a substantial amount higher than the COLA. So anyway, so we're basically going to be preparing a level service budget for discussion at our public hearing. But we will provide information for other scenarios that may be defined by the commission, the city manager, or the council, which, like we've done in the past. We've always provided a level service. We've separated out any new adds, which we won't have this year. excuse me. And then we've also done any reduction scenarios that have been requested. So that'll be on the docket later on in the month as the council and the city manager decide, you know, what direction they want to move us in. So during the budget process, we prepare and submit what can be referred to as an infrastructure budget. The way I look at our budget is we basically, you know, try and get some sort of framework to work in with the staffing we need, the supplies we need, and the goals. But unfortunately, every single fiscal year, things just don't go as planned most of the time. So basically, after listening to the council meeting with some of the counselors questioning why you might budget $1,000 for a line item and then it shows that we haven't expended that by the end of the fiscal year, you know, what things impact that, and then also surpluses at the end of the year, I consider it to be a very positive thing. So I know one of the questions came up at one of the council meetings about surpluses and how we budget. So I just wanted to address those basically give you an idea of what things can impact our budget. I mean, there's simple explanations that during the fiscal year, an employee may resign and we might have a vacancy for 2 months or 3 months. You might have an unanticipated training opportunity that you didn't budget for, but you have to find the funds somewhere. There might be new technology introduced. A new grant might become available. But it has a match requirement. So you have to see if you can, you know, finagle that. So basically decisions are made several times a month throughout the year to accommodate these types of events and changes and things like that. Because again, the budget is a living document. Under patrol, this is perhaps our biggest variable, is the shift scheduling and staffing. There are so many things that go into this aspect of policing. We plan for an average number of open beat coverages that can be annual leave, can be FMLA, military training, injured, all sorts of leaves that we have to cover. So there's sort of like a formula that we put together so that we at least have, you know, a general budget to cover things like that. But then you throw in like a work-related injury that's long, you know, that will last quite a long time, or you're navigating quarantines, we really have to really finagle with our budget during that time period. Last year, we had to implement platooning to ensure we had enough staff on to cover the city because we had quite a few people out, and we're currently almost in that position again. Due to quarantines, but also due to FMLAs and things like that. So basically, you know, you have to be so fluid and you have to be able to move on a dime with your budget. In terms of directed
traffic, and I just add to the staffing thing there that we have minimum manning requirements where we have to have a minimum number of officers for safety purposes on the street, which also adds into that staffing issue and overtime.
Chief or Karen, can you elaborate when you say platooning? So I understand what would trigger the need to move into a different staffing model given a certain number of people are quarantining or unable to report for duty. So what are the budget implications? Is it that we end up paying a lot more overtime because you're asking people to come in who wouldn't otherwise be scheduled? Are we having to pay other you know, municipalities for backup? Like what? Say more about what it means to be platooning.
So when we went to platooning, we basically put all of our resources into patrol and moved everybody out of all the other positions. So we had enough people. So in one way, we had more than enough people assigned to specific shifts. We worked 12-hour shifts instead of working our normal 10-hour shifts, which allowed us to have enough officers to cover our minimum levels. But when the officers that were working were all getting overtime that they normally wouldn't get. So it's kind of a counterbalance, but it just depended on how many people were available. And fortunately, when we went to it, we weren't down many numbers, but we're getting to that point now between quarantines and people out on FMLA and people out on different types of leave that we're starting to get to that critical number where we at least have to put in consideration to be prepared. But hopefully we can weather the storm and not have to go back to the platooning levels.
And is there any other costs incurred related to the switch? I mean, I understand 10-hour days versus 12-hour days. Are there, you know, if independent of the overtime, is there any other costs incurred related to having to move into that staffing model?
There are other costs, but more of it's overtime. And then it's like changing of everybody's shifts could create an overlap with people working more days than they would have because they would have been on days off, but now the days got changed. So there were some costs in that, and Karen could probably answer more of those, what the actual costs were.
I was gonna say, it was pretty substantial when we had to platoon. We did send that into FEMA. I don't know if we've heard back yet in reference to those funds, but it was close to about $70,000. It was a lot of money. But we had to make sure that if each platoon lost two or three or four people, it would still be able to function. So that was the reason for that.
What about detectives, Chief? If the detectives were put into uniform at that point when COVID happened, mm-hmm. How about their cases that were basically, I mean, they have to go back into and spend overtime when they get back into normal situations and work on cases that were delayed?
Yeah, I mean, basically the detective investigations were basically put on hold unless there was something that was critical that needed to be investigated. But if there was a case that actively was being worked, then if they weren't working, basically if they weren't working on a scheduled patrol platoon shift, they came in on their days off and worked on overtime to wrap up their investigations.
Okay.
And this is my sixth budget cycle, Karen Senecal, and we've always returned money. What happens? I'm just not familiar with a scenario where we go in the red. We exceed our budget. What happens in those scenarios?
Well, we're usually in our projections, we're watching that very closely, and we project out through the end of the fiscal year on July 1st. So basically, we would go to the city council. They have contingency funds, and we would justify why we would need those funds, what they would be to get us through the end of the fiscal year, and hopefully get approved for those.
Yeah. And what would you say on average the amount we return?
There have been years. Actually, I have that in the very last slide because I do talk about surpluses.
Okay. Yeah, let's wait there.
But things like DPW, you know, they put a certain amount. Yeah, they put a certain amount of. Go ahead.
No, I had a different question before.
It's things like DPW, just like we budget our overtime. Okay, do you want to do that first?
No, go ahead, finish. Okay. You can finish.
No, I was just gonna say, like in DPW, they just like we do with our overtime, they do the same thing with snow removal. If you recall, we had that horrible year of snow and they went over budget. So, I mean, it's obviously explainable and justifiable. So it's just when you get those weird out of the norm things that you do have that recourse to go request a contingency.
Well, predicting snow is like predicting crime.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Before we move off this topic, so platooning, it seems like one of those examples where, you know, if we present with a level funded budget, but we are anticipating additional staffing expenditures related to the COVID reality, we could even tease it out, as you mentioned, the amount to FEMA at 70,000. You know, as we're thinking about how we present, it might be useful to have those numbers just so that when we have to make the case for what the additional expenses are in light of the pandemic, we can actually point to that as a perfect example.
All right. And just to add to that is, depending on what time of year that events like that happen in our budget cycle, you know, sometimes we may be way over, as Karen had stated we were, but as the year plays itself out and we get close to the end of the year, we may have surpluses in other places that offset that. So at the end, we may not have to make a request for additional funding.
I was gonna say, we've all been in the city well-trained to do our best to cover any of these anomalies in our budget or, you know, events that happen. To try to do our best to cover as much as possible to try to avoid going for a contingency. So a lot of times we shut down things or, you know, we avoid doing certain projects or whatever that particular fiscal year we have to. So in terms of dispatch, this is another instance. We have had difficulty recruiting in this area. We currently have a couple of positions open, but they're part of the 24/7 365. We have to have two dispatchers there all the time. So right now, even though the positions are open, I have to cover them all on overtime because there's no shift relief factor right now in dispatch. So we're also having to have officers come in so that the dispatchers don't get overworked themselves. So that creates another situation that you just have to, again, be very fluid with your budget and accommodate. general investigations and technology this year. With the COVID relief funds under ICAC, we got some technology, a subscription to a tool that helps with computer crimes and whatnot. It's to the tune of $100,000. We've only got it for 12 months, but I guess it's just, there's just no comparison to anything that this technology has helped our detectives with. So, you know, you think at the end of the 12 months, what are you going to do? You can't put $100,000 in your budget. So again, looking at these different types of events, you have to try and be creative. Since it's a New Hampshire ICAC tool, task force tool, you know, we're contemplating seeing if any of the other police departments will kick in some money to see if we can keep this tool in place, because I guess it's just phenomenal to do that. Special Investigations Unit, you know, we currently have a detective assigned to the FBI and a detective assigned to the DEA. A lot of their cases do benefit Portsmouth tremendously. We also have one in-house person under this section, but if those get suspended or go away, you know, the work is still there. It's just more cumbersome without the federal government helping you. So, you know, we always have to keep that in the back burner because it's only a year-to-year MOU that we have with them. The Internet Crimes Against Children, again, we have that tool. The caseload, I guess, in ICAC, all over the state and in Portsmouth, is so substantial that, I mean, we could easily add 10 investigators and still not be able to handle all the caseload. You know, we've gotten tons of money from the federal government. We've gotten a lot of money from the state. John Paracki, Lieutenant Paracki, has, you know, made substantial inroads into getting things set up into regions and whatnot. But again, the caseload is so substantial. So that would be something, you know, the chiefs would have to get together and see, you know, if everybody can spread it out or whatever, or add detectives here or whatnot. So, you know, their staffing is always a question, you know, trying to solve problems like that. You push off year to year to year. So it's just all things that go into our budget process and budget request.
Go ahead. I was gonna say, just to add to the ICAC funding there, is that obviously during the COVID, there's been a significant spike. And fortunately, federal government has added additional funding, which we've used, but, you know, as Karen just stated, that's short-lived money. And then when that runs out, we need to find money elsewhere to, you know, keep that going. The equipment we're getting is state of the art, but as you know, the digital world and technology, it changes monthly, you know, so to stay on top of that, we have to keep reinvesting the equipment. And, you know, as long as the grant's there, that covers a lot of it, but at some point we have to have the funds available to keep that equipment and keep it operating.
That's where I was going to go with this. You know, we get all this federal money and it provides for personnel, technology, et cetera. Are we also as a community putting in resources toward this? And if so, are the other police departments and communities in the state chipping in as well? And if not, can we leverage more and request more support from other communities, especially given it sounds like, by all accounts, the number of, you know, these child violence activities online are escalating in number, and with a set amount of money, many of these are being put off, right?
Yeah. So just, and Karen, correct me if I'm accurate in some of these things. So we have other communities that are participating by offering personnel, which, you know, the government doesn't cover salary. It covers the overtime and it's covering the cost of the equipment. But the officers that are actually doing the investigations is being paid for by all the local communities that are involved in the ICAC task force. And as Karen stated, Lieutenant Paraki has done an excellent job in expanding that and bringing on other members from all across the state, but especially here on the Seacoast. We have been fortunate where we just set up our own lab here in Portsmouth. So before we were going to Manchester where the main lab was, but with this additional funding, we've got our lab set up here with almost the same equipment they have in Manchester. So now, you know, all the local communities in the area that are participating with us can now come here and send their officers here to work on the equipment that we have here. So yeah. To answer your question, yes, they're all participating. But once that money runs out and we need to renew the licensing for all that equipment, that's what Karen's talking about, of where can we get some cooperation with, you know, paying for the license, like that one piece of equipment that she's talking about that can get into any phone right now with, you know, minimal amount of effort is $100,000 that's going to be renewed yearly.
This is another example of, as far as your budget goes, unpredictability. An ICAC case could go on 3, 6, 8 a year long, involve several different agencies. And so you could never predict that budget on a case that comes in. And that case could come in tonight. And you're going to have this whole unit working on this case for 6, 8 months or less or more. But predicting something like that is just, like before, is like predicting snow. It's the same thing.
Correct.
This does seem like one of the areas where we can feel more confident about additional federal resource, state and federal resource, because it's an area that I think, I mean, given we were able to get the resources we did once COVID hit, and I think as Karen just articulated, there's ways to make compelling case that Karen and Tom, compelling cases that this just doesn't go away now because we've got the equipment, we have to have the people available to do the prosecuting and the fault investigating.
Correct. Okay, so personnel and training under COVID has been challenging because you have to keep your distance and whatnot. We've been able to transition to some online training for this period, but there's still quite a bit of training that the department has to do and qualifications and things like that. That have to be done in person, and where before you could fill a training room with 20 or 30, now you have to have more sessions with fewer people. So again, that there's more cost to that. Court office, caseload is significant. We currently have 1.5 prosecutors. I think we've expressed multiple times that we probably need 2. And right now we have a sworn person and detectives doing the juvenile prosecutions. And we have discussed, but haven't moved on, seeing if we could get another half-time prosecutor in the court office to handle those. So the sworn personnel could go back to doing sworn items. The victim advocate, I know we've been talking in the forums about, you know, social workers and things like that. The victim advocate, I just got an email today stating that the funding, she's funded in 2 different things, the Violence Against Women's Grant and the Victims of Crime Grant. And I was just told that the Victim of Crime Grant is probably going to be substantially reduced. I asked how much. And they said, you know, probably a minimum of 15%. So I have to build things like that into our budget. If it turns out to be more or less, it'll be either a surplus or a deficit when it comes time for us to get awarded our money. So that's pretty much all the things that like impact our budget. I mean, that's just a very quick review of just things that have come up in not a very long period of time. So when you're looking at a 12 month budget, it's just constant. There's constant impacts, events, things that you just have to, you know, be fluid with and, you know, be able to roll with things, you know, push things off, et cetera. So that's why when you're looking at our budget, and I'm sure any other budget in the city, they experience the exact same thing. If they've budgeted $1,000 for something and only spent $500, there's a reason for that. So every year is different. Sometimes it's the same. We just don't know. Surpluses, I love end of year surpluses. I think that they're a very positive thing. It's a good thing to return money back to the city. Like if you have vacancies and you have salary savings, if you have a training that got canceled, whatever. An end of year surplus is probably the best thing in the world. I get very afraid of the red. So I know some discussions have been brought up about end of year surpluses, meaning potentially that you're not budgeting properly or whatever. But we do budget properly. We budget for that infrastructure framework that we start to work with on July 1st. And based on everything that happens during the fiscal year, you could be in the red or the black. You could have to ask for a contingency or whatnot. We've always had an end of year surplus. Luckily, this year, thanks to FEMA, we probably will continue to be in the black. But here is just a bird's eye view from 1996. I came in 2001.
Thank God.
So, I think it's a good
hell
thing.
Of a track record.
Yeah, I think it's a good thing to return money if, there are things at the end of every year or during the fiscal year that we didn't budget for that we do purchase. But for the most part, it's a positive thing to return funds to the coffers to help offset other like big one-time purchases in the undesignated fund balance and whatnot. So,
and I'm going to add an additional variable why we've been so successful at returning money, and we're looking at the primary factor, and it's Karen Senecal, who is not afraid to say no to staff members who would like this overtime or would like that. And she's not afraid to say no. And Karen, I want to thank you. You guard our budget like mamas guard their cubs.
Yeah. Well, it's just that I know I could be fired if I went in the red. No reason.
I think with this track record, you could screw up a few years.
It's called job security.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Just I'm going back on the juvenile court. How many days a week are they doing that? Is it one or two?
It all depends on the week. I mean, it's in and itself, it consumes we have a detective sergeant back there that
right.
does the juvenile prosecution. And, it's generally at least 2 to 3 days a week, but depending on the day-to-day what goes on, if we have a juvenile that maybe having some issues that has to be addressed, then it could turn into a non-scheduled day that becomes a scheduled day. So it's fluid.
And if they have an adjudication or if they have a chins petition or dispositional hearings to go to, that must tie that officer up for, it just must be his job and that's it. And I think if I'm not mistaken, I think a lot of the agencies are getting away from police prosecuting like this department has to get attorneys in there instead of the police officer, because one, you're tying that police officer up solely on that purpose rather than doing an investigation, they're in court, and then you have the attorney there instead of that. Is that true from around the state of New Hampshire?
Yes, that is correct. I mean, there was a lot of PDs that have police officers or supervisors that are doing not only the juvenile prosecution, but the regular prosecution as well. Taking an officer off of the street or from some other type of investigation case that they could be working on to tie up with prosecution. And we've been pushing to try to fill an extra half position to take over that role. And it's court, it's legal stuff. It's, we're fortunate at this time right now, the actual sergeant in there is actually a lawyer, but it hasn't always been the case. And, it's obviously more beneficial to have an attorney there than a police officer.
Okay, thanks, Chief. Appreciate it.
Can I also ask a question, Karen? As you're building the budget, I assume the staffing model reflects the changes that have been precipitated by the new chief and some of the promotions that are underway or going to need to be underway as a result?
Yes, and actually that's another reason why, I'm not going to put any numbers on it because I've just got, placeholders in there. And we'll wait and see what happens with those placeholders, who moves and stuff like that.
Great.
Yeah, those will be resolved in the next month or so.
Yeah.
I want to jump back to the court issue. You know, I'm speculating, Chief, but is it fair to say that if the courts weren't so backed up, mm-hmm. municipalities wouldn't be burning a lot of money while city reps sit and wait for the court case?
It's the prosecution work is there regardless of whether or not the courts are backed up. You know, actually going to, you know, virtual with the courts has actually kind of sped up the process now that they've got it, got it working, and has kind of got the court system digitalized, and we're also catching up on that end. But it's not any less work. It's just different work.
Okay. So is that your presentation, Karen?
That's it. I just wanted to address, you know, all the things that can impact a budget year that you have no control over and you couldn't predict it. So, and then the surpluses being a very positive end to the fiscal year.
Right. And I'd just like to mention under the personnel and training, especially with the training this year, with pretty much everything going virtual, we've had to purchase, you know, virtual online training, which has been a cost. You know, it's somewhat been offset because generally training can cost us a lot more money in overtime, which we haven't had to incur as much because of being able to do it online. People are able to accessible through computers and working hours more so than having to reschedule people. But it's also, you know, additional costs and things that we did not initially have planned because obviously at the time we didn't know everything was going to be virtual. And I would like to state too that we have minimum training requirements that every officer in the department has to have. And even with the COVID and everything being shut down, that standard has not changed. We've still had to maintain all the training hours that are required.
And we want training. We know that training's critical. You know, we had a conversation two nights ago about, you know, implementing body cameras at $1 million over 7 years versus allocating a portion of that kind of money toward increased training and de-escalation training and understanding of psychology and drug addictions, et cetera. So we got to keep up the training. Chief, what do you think of the quality of the online trainings relative to in-person?
Well, it depends on what the training is. You know, you just mentioned the de-escalation. We found some virtual online de-escalation training that I thought was very good. It was well received by the officers. So it just depends on what the subject is.
Yeah. And I like the one you shared with me. I thought that was terrific.
Yeah. That was de-escalation.
Yeah. So are there any other presentation items at this point? And I see no. Do we have any members of the public that want to speak?
Nope, we don't.
Okay, so we had a meeting scheduled for Commissioner Shaheen. You've got a question?
Comment? Nope, I'm just trying to fix my light.
Okay. So we've got a meeting scheduled for this exact time, 3:30 to 5:30, a week from today. I'm going to suggest that we postpone that meeting. I don't think in a week we're going to have much of an update. And why don't we leave it to the chief and Karen to let us know when you've got some updates, and we'll get updates from the city council as well about, you know, what we're going to have to collectively think through in terms of meeting a budget cap stipulated by the city council. Any idea when they're going to start throwing percentages at us, maximum cap increases or any of that?
I was going to say, I think they have another budget meeting next week or the week after. So yeah. I'm sure they'll get that more refined at that time.
So it looks like
probably in the next month.
Yeah.
So today it's the 14th of January. We're talking the we probably won't have another budget workshop meeting like this for at least a month to 6 weeks, right?
Correct. I was going to say, once the level services budget is completed, and we know exactly where we're at, moving on from there will be the workshop stuff that we need to talk about.
Yeah, good. Any other comments, questions, suggestions?
Other than thank you.
Okay, welcome.
Great work. And thanks to City Manager Kennard. I think it's great that she's willing to join and give us a sense of the broader context. It's always great to hear.
Yes. And
it's been good. And we've been all been working collaboratively, so we're all on the same page.
Good. And so our next meeting is next week. We'll have our monthly police commission meeting on Tuesday the 19th, 5:30. I think we're starting at 5. Because Chief, I believe you have another budget meeting that night. So we're going to start at 5 o'clock on the 19th. Normally we start at 5:30. And I look forward to that meeting. No other comments, and we can move to adjournment with a motion.
So moved.
Second.
And on a roll call vote, Commissioner Shaheen.
Aye.
Commissioner Hart.
Aye.
I say aye as well. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Chief. And we'll see you next week.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye, everybody. See you in a little while.